Program, AY stands for Advent Youth, Adventist Youth, and this is a program that was created by the GC, the General Conference, years ago. The idea of the AY program, we have the three angels' messages that is displayed in the logo, and who knows the three angels' messages? They're preaching the gospel, yes, to all. And the AY program was created for the youth, the Seventh-day Adventist youth, to learn together, to study, to come up with programs that they are learning for their spiritual development. And there's where they get a platform in the church on the Sabbath afternoons to give the AY studies. Years ago, the AY program, so when I'm talking back home, some of you might relate to this too. The AY programs used to be conducted or held by the youth. Today, if you look at AY programs, afternoons, most of the time it's all people who are above between 50 and 70 years old. So everyone goes home, but the elderly people who are accustomed of the AY program, because AY is AY, they come back out in the afternoon. Where are the youth? The AY program helps to get our youth involved in the ministry, help them to study together and grow spiritually together. If we do not provide a program for our youth in our church, what is there for our youth to do? Most of the time we find youth being occupied with other things outside of the church. And that is why I want to encourage every one of you to listen today to our first AY program. This is our first AY program, and by the grace of God, we know that this will not be the last AY program. Amen? We need our youth active in the church. We have a set of youths here, it's not complete, but we have a handful of youth here today, and we need youth active in the church. In these end times, everything out there is happening. Everything is so actual. The devil is finding a way outside, making even sometimes inside, making things look so attractive. And who is the prey? Youth, young people. So let us continue to encourage the youth to take a stand, to come up with programs. And we, the youth ministry department leaders, we are supporting the youths with that. We are stimulating, we are supporting, we are guiding them, and they are free to come up with their own program, and we look at the program. This program today that will be brought to you, by the way, the youth department committee, we have committees. The committee for our AY program for the year is Sister Revelyn and Brother Arnold. What you will see today, what you have seen so far, has been put together by this committee. Myself and Elder Enoch have not done anything, really anything. And we are thanking the Lord for the gifts, because we are seeing that in our youths in the church, they are gifts. But we need to give them the chance to show the gift, to come closer to God. So we hope that this AY program, that you will enjoy this AY program, and that when you leave from here today, you will say, our youths are ready.
Amen.
So at this moment, I just want to say, since it's our first AY program, we want to celebrate it also. So if you're staying back, I will actually advise you to stay back. If you're a sweet tooth lover. Because we have something that we want to celebrate this. And we give God the thanks, because this is not the end of our AY program. And we have our AY cake. I don't know if you can see it, with our AY logo.
Wow.
So you will taste and see that the Lord is good.
Amen.
Taste and see. You'll first taste the spiritual parts, and you will testify that He is good. And the youth will continue to bless you. And after, we will taste and see. Amen. Welcome to our AY Youth Program.
Let us see. Together we pray and work and play in happy harmony. We have a friend to
we've had a bit of fun, and I hope you all warm and be ready for the next part of the program. Next part of the program is going to be a bit more serious, and it's entitled Pillars of Faith. As Seventh Adventists, as the brother said, there were five things that are like signature to Adventists, or that we should really know the five things. And one of these things, one of the things we would like to speak about today, and it's part of prophecy. We can ask ourselves, what is faith? And the Bible definition, I think most of us have heard it, and it says, faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things unseen. So another, we could use the word belief, sometimes we use that word to subsidize the word faith. And then a question that I ask myself often is, how do I support my faith? When other people ask me, why you believe what you believe? I kind of like to have an answer, and I hate to think that people think that I'm just a sheep and I just follow in, and because my parents kind of put me here and it kind of sound good, you know, I'm here. So when I sit down and think, I was like, you know, what have really strengthened my faith was the things I understand about the prophecy, the things I've learned in history. When you look out in nature, it's just, you can't compare, you can't find any other explanation for it. And also our personal experiences. Today we would like to shine some light on the history part of our faith. Because we know we have different stories that we can hear. For example, you have Christmas, right now we have Easter. But we could always go back in history and check to see, is it real and does it make sense? And then we also have the story like the story of Jesus, which we're like, yeah, we know the story of Jesus and we believe it really happened. We believe Jesus died on the cross. And sometimes you could even go back and dig in history to see if the stories of the Bible are really true. For example, Daniel and the prophecy. Today we'd like to zoom in a bit more, and we will be speaking about the Reformers. The Reformers lived in a time that we like to call the Dark Ages. That's because there wasn't a Bible there anymore. The only Bible was mostly in a foreign language, for example, Latin. So the common people couldn't read it, and that's why it's called the Dark Ages, the age where there was no light, there was no word of God for the people. The 1260 prophecy, maybe someone could read it for me. Daniel 7, verse 25.
Against the Most High, and shall wear out the saints of the Most High, and think to change times and laws, and they shall be given into his hand until a time and times and the dividing of time, which is 1260 years.
Okay, so right now we will be speaking about the wearing out of the saints, because in this prophecy, I don't know if you remember the timeline, it started in 538 when the papacy. That's when it moved out, but the papacy came to power in the church path. And they wanted all the power. And it was like, if we want to tell the people that they're supposed to worship us and they're supposed to follow our rules, what are we going to do? We're going to take away the real law. We're going to take away the Bible. And this is what made the age that dark. Okay? Now I would like to invite Mrs. Shanika, as she would lead us into this part of the prophecy.
Hello everyone. Please say a prayer in your heart for my voice. It has left me this week, but God is good regardless. This part of the program is taken from chapter 4 of the Great Controversy, and it's also called Faithful Unto Death, The World Then Sees. Many years ago, there was a group of people who lived in the mountains of South Central Europe. They loved God and their Bibles, and as a result, they were persecuted and hunted for their faith. What caused it all? How did they survive? Did they survive? The Waldenses were a pre-Protestant movement that was founded by Peter Waldo in 1173. In lands beyond the jurisdiction of Rome, there existed for many centuries bodies of Christians who remained almost wholly free from papal corruption. They were surrounded by the hedonism, and in the lapse of the ages, were affected by its errors. But they continued to regard the Bible as the only rule of faith and adhere to many of its truths. These Christians believe in the perpetuity of the law of God and observe the Sabbath, a fourth commandment. But those who resisted the encroachments of the papal power, the Waldenses stood foremost. The faith which for centuries was held and taught by the Waldensian Christian was marked in contrast to the false doctrines put forth in Rome. Through ages of darkness and apostasy, there were Waldenses who denied the supremacy of Rome, who rejected image worship as idolatry, and who kept the true Sabbath. Under the fiercest tempest and opposition, they maintained their faith. Like I said, Peter Waldo, due to circumstances, he realized that the way of life was not the way it should be, and he gave up everything he had and changed his lifestyle, and he began teaching. And while he taught in the crowds, people started coming more, and he formed a group, and they were, you know, they started a movement. And like I said, in 1170, Waldo had gathered many followers, and they were also referred as the poor of Lyons, the poor of Lombardy, or the poor of God. They evangelized their teachings while traveling as peddlers. They were often referred as the Waldensians or the Waldenses. The Waldenses were the first people of Europe to also obtain to translate their own scripture. Hundreds of years before the Reformation, they possessed the entire Bible in manuscript in their native tongue. They had the truth unaltered, and this rendered them special objects in hatred and persecution. They declared the Church of Rome to be apostate Babylon of the apocalypse, and at the peril of their lives, they stood up and resisted her corruptions. While under the pressure of long-continued persecution, some compromised their faith, little by little, yielding its distinctive principles, others held fast to the truth. Also, the Waldenses also preached several truths they learned from the Bible. As you see on the screen, they also included the atoning death and justifying righteousness of Christ, the Godhead, the fall of man, the incarnation of the Son, a denial of purgatory as the invention of the Antichrist, and valued voluntary equality. As you know, the Waldenses, this movement, it infuriated the Roman Catholic Church. They viewed the Waldenses as unorthodox. In 1184, at the Synod of Verona, they were denounced as heretics under the auspices of Pope Lucius III. And between the years 1211 and 1215, several Waldenses were burned as heretics. They were burned at the stake for their sacrifices. Also, lies were being spread that the Waldenses were practicing witchcraft, and that also caused them to also die at stake. Okay. The history of God's faithful people for hundreds of years after Rome attained to power is known alone to heaven. They cannot be traced in human records except as hints of their existence are found in the centuries of accusations of their persecutors. It was the policy of Rome to obliterate every trace of dissent from her doctrines or decrees. Everything heretical, whether persons or writings, was destroyed. A single oppression of doubt, a question as to authority of papal dogmas, was enough to cost the life of rich or poor, high or low. Rome endeavored also to destroy every record of her cruelty toward dissenters. Papal councils decreed that books and writings containing such records should be committed into flames. Before the invention of printing, books were few and in a form of not favorable for the preservation. Therefore, there was a little to prevent the Romanists from carrying their purpose. But you know, in life, that as we go on as Christians, realize that God also has a plan for us. And the Waldenses, persecution led them to, you know, live among the Alps along the French-Italian border, across northern Italy, southern Switzerland, and western Austria. Behind the lofty bulwarks of mountains, in all ages, the refuge of the persecuted and the oppressed, the Waldenses found a hiding place. Here, the lamp of truth was kept burning during the long night that descended upon Christendom. Here, for 1,000 years, they maintained their ancient faith. Through dark ages and apostasy, there were Waldenses who denied the supremacy of Rome, who rejected image worship and as idolatry, who kept the true Sabbath. As we continue to the rest of the program and the rest of the history, I would like to leave this passage behind. From Proverbs chapter 3, verses 1 to 6. My son, forget not my law, but let thine heart keep my commandments. For length of days and long life and peace shall add to thee. Let not mercy and truth forsake thee. Bind them up about thy neck, write them upon the table of thine heart. So thou shalt find favor and good understanding in the sight of God and man. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not unto thy own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy path.
You guys a bit about John Wycliffe. John Wycliffe, while the Waldenses were busy in Europe and the Alps, busy spreading a message, in England, John Wycliffe was born he was born in 1328. And he grew up in a town called Yorkshire in England. And his parents were simple people. And they brought him up as best as they could bring him up with also a bit of Christianity. And he did have the fear of the Lord in his heart, even as a child. As he grew up, his interest went more and more in things as theology and law and philosophy. His encounter with theology in college made him very, very hungry for truth. He would be looking, and every time he got the chance, he would just be digging in the Word. And as he studied, as most reformers, he encountered a few truths. He realized that the plan of salvation, which is through Christ, and he also realized that Christ was the only advocate for man. He realized that the salvation and the Christ was the only advocate for man. As he continued to study, he realized that devotion to truth leads you in conflict with falsehood. Back in that time, because the Roman Empire was so powerful, most of the teachers and stuff like that were Roman influence. And they would teach the kids, and sometimes would even carry them home, like encourage them to join monasteries and stuff, without the permission of the parents. And this is a really serious thing. Imagine you go to school, and one day you're going to school in a normal public school, or in a Christian school, and the next day you find yourself being encouraged to join the monastery, and you thinking you'll go home and talk it over with your parents, but it's not so. You decide to just pick up yourself and leave. And when you go to those kinds of places, often you don't have contact with your family and your friends anymore. And when he studied, he was looking around, and he was looking at the influences that the Roman Empire or the Catholic Church, the Roman Church, had on his community. And he realized that what they're doing wasn't right. Some of the errors that he encountered was that the Word of God was replaced with human tradition. So the tradition of the church had become more important than what was literally in the Bible, because in his studies, he learned the language of Latin. So he was one of the people who could have read the Bible. And by reading the Bible, he found out these things. Because he studied so well, he even became like a master in theology, and he was teaching at church, he was teaching at schools at Oxford, and he was a bishop also, so he was also teaching the people, so he had full access to the truth. He realized that payment of tribute was not something that God had asked his people to do. Back in the day, for example, the whole of England would have to send money to Rome for protection. He also realized that church and state should be separated, that church should not have influence on political issues. That was basically what he was saying. And that monks couldn't really hear your confession and forgive you. As he was studying, he realized that, no, I have to tell the people. So he decided to start to write tracts, and he gave out these tracts. Everywhere he go, eventually people read them. They were They were kind of happy with this message because they felt oppressed. So they would join him and they would also go out and tell others. But of course, he had a group of people who were holding on to tradition and kind of the safe way, who would still pay the prayers for the protection of Peter, for confession and stuff like that. But those who read it, Wycliffe's trust for them, found it, it was a relief to know that they didn't have to do all these things, that they didn't have to do penances, or that they would have to do things to be forgiven. For example, they would probably have to climb stairs on their knees, or probably go without food or something like that. Some of them realized that they wouldn't have to do these things. So as Wycliffe spread his message and the truth that he found and those people who were helping him, there were some obstacles. Of course, I mean, if there's someone in power and you try and contradict them, it's not going to go as smoothly as you think it would go. In the beginning, it wasn't his objective to overthrow Rome or to become an enemy of Rome, but he was like, I'm going to bring a revival. I'm going to bring something good. And when they see what I'm saying is true, they're going to accept me and we're all going to be good. But that's not what happened. Eventually, two of the bishops realized that what he was doing was taking away power from them, and they decided to bring him to trial, and they were like, we're going to try you, and hopefully in the end it's not going to end up good for you. But his words are just so true. When you put the Bible on the table, you can't put anything else on top of it that is not true. It would be clear as anything. So when he was going to his trial, two princes accompanied him, and also the people accompanied him, and the bishops got so scared, they let him go. And then after that, he just went on and preaching his gospel and stuff like that. Eventually, the papacy heard about him, and they sent out a papal bull after him. A papal bull is something that if the papacy would tell the country to, hey, this man here, please, when you meet him, stop him from speaking. If possible, even kill him, but stop him from speaking. But he also was able to overcome that. Eventually, the Pope who sent out that bull, he died. And also the King of England died. And the following king was a friend of Wycliffe. So he was even better off after that. God protected him. In this time, Wycliffe also started to translate the Bible. He realized that this truth was so important. He wasn't the only person that supposed to read this. So he translated this Bible, and while he was busy, he got sick. And he got really, really sick. Most people thought he was going to die. So of course, the bishops and the priests was like, okay, we're going to go. And they went beside his bed like, Brother Wycliffe, these are your last few days. Anything you would like to say? And they really thought he was going to be like, you all were right, this Christianity is nothing. But he said, you know what? I'm not going to die. I'm going to live, and I'm going to show you what is truth. And eventually he did get better, and he was able to finish translating the Bible to give it to all his fellow people so that they could also read. As he translated the Bible, and eventually, of course, the Romans in Italy, like the Pope himself, was like, we have to stop him. So they summoned him. And he himself was like, okay, I guess Rome summoned me, I have to go now. And he knew that it was going to be his death. So he prepared to go, but God had another plan for him. As he was preparing to go, he got really, really sick. So he couldn't go, and he wrote a letter to Rome, to the Pope, stating his truth. And the way he wrote his letters was so with such intellectual word, and it wasn't an aggressive letter. It was a letter that if you read it, you wouldn't be able to really pick up this man and throw him in prison like they wanted to do. And since he didn't go, he decided like he would go to his own church. And as he was speaking that day, he had a stroke and he fell with they call it palsy. So he was lame on one side of his body after he got the stroke. And as he lay in bed and he lay there after his stroke, that's how he passed away. So they didn't get to burn him at the stake like some of the other reformers. He passed away being really sick. But that was not enough for Rome. Rome was not going to leave it there. You could imagine that about 40 years later, they decided to pick up Wycliffe's bones and they burned that. But little did the Roman church know that these kind of things does not stop Christianity and it doesn't stop truth from spreading. By them burning his bones, it was a symbol of the power that his message had. 40 years later, the influence of his translations and his tracts that he shared out, 40 years later, it still had such a huge impact that they decided to go and punish him even then. A quote that I would like to leave with you, and that is found in the Great Controversy page, about page 92 to 94, it says, "The study of the Bible will ennoble every thought, feeling, and aspiration as no other study can. It gives stability of purpose, patience, courage, and fortitude. It refines the character and sanctifies the soul. An earnest, reverent study of Scripture, bringing the mind of the student in direct contact with the infinite mind, would give to the world men of strong and more active intellect, as well as a nobler principle, than has ever resulted from the ablest training that human philosophy affords." I think this is a very powerful statement, because the only thing we really have is our character, and that determines our future.
Mm-hmm.
Good afternoon, everyone. Our next reformer is also a John. I think there is power in the name John, but anyways. This reformer is from Bohemia. John Huss was born in Budisic, actually a small village in Bohemia. And Bohemia is like the western part of the Czech Republic that we know nowadays. And John Huss was not necessarily a child of which you would think that he would be very successful. He comes from a rich, influential family. Not at all. His parents were very simple people. His father died when he was very young. And his mother was a woman who feared the Lord. And she taught her son that education and godliness were the two most important things in life. And I think that her son honored her teachings. And John Huss later moved with his mother to Prague, the capital city of Czech Republic, and he had like an amazing academic career. Before his 23rd, I'm 23, so I feel a bit like, before his 23rd, he had a Master of Arts already and a Master of Philosophy. Wow. He was Doctor of Arts at the University of Prague, and within some years later, he also became professor, and later he became rector of the University of Prague, and he also became a Catholic priest. So John Huss was someone that was sincere in his desire to obey the Lord and to do what the Lord expects from him in life. Nevertheless, he had his own encounter with truth, because he got works from Wycliffe, from Jerome of Prague, who later became Jerome of Prague was also a very wise man, had all different kinds of degrees, and studied at different universities, different countries. So he took works of Wycliffe to Bohemia, and also to Prague, of course. And that is how John Huss also got an encounter with those truths that Wycliffe had presented to the people. But also he was inspired when two English evangelists came to Prague, and they actually made a painting on a square. I think quite some of us would know this painting. It's a painting of, on one side you have Jesus riding on a donkey, lowly, meek, etc., poor. And on the other side you have the Pope, who is with all his nice attributes and all his jewelry and whatever. He's riding a fancy horse. And this painting actually made John Huss to think, like, it doesn't seem to fit with the papacy and the whole Roman Catholic system. Doesn't seem to go along with the Jesus from the Bible. And of course he did his own Bible study, which helped him to get certain insights. I will show a picture of the painting, or what it would look like probably, kind of. You can see the clear distinction between Jesus and the Pope. And I think in this sense, sometimes pictures speak even clearer than words. So, what were John Huss's teachings? Him being a priest himself, he was witnessing the kind of immorality that was present among the other priests. like they were sexually immoral, they drank, they sold indulgences and all these kind of immoral things. So he was disturbed by that, and he started to teach a higher level of morality among the priests, as it was written in the Bible, that priests should not defile themselves with women, with wine, etc. And also, as Reverend said, the Bible was not translated in their language, the language in the Czech Republic. And he was very much in favor of giving the word to the people so they can just study for themselves and learn for themselves. So him as a priest, he also was the leader of a chapel in Prague, and he started to preach these things as well, of course. He was also very much in favor of full communion for everyone. I had to laugh when I read this piece, because obviously the Catholic priest thought the normal people, the lay people, were so stupid that if you would give them the cup of wine, that they would just be like, you know, spilling it everywhere and making a mess. And they thought that them, yeah, as unholy people, they were not worthy to receive the wine and to, you know, the blood of Christ as they saw it, of course. So John Huss said, okay, everyone should just be able to take part in full communion, as we do nowadays, praise the Lord. And lastly, he also taught the supremacy of the scriptures over church leaders. So it's not what the priest said that is necessary truth, but eventually we have to go back to the Bible to sort out what is truth for ourselves. And of course, this still goes for us nowadays. Then, yeah, well, surprisingly, the papacy was not so happy with John Huss. And at a certain point, when his teaching started to get more known among the people, they called him to appear before the Pope. And John Huss had also, just as John Wycliffe, he made friends with very influential people. The king was a friend of his, all these noble people, scholars, professors. He had some good connections, to say so. And these acquaintances of him, they actually wrote a letter to the papacy asking the papacy to not, you know, to cancel the call, basically, and to just leave him in peace, which the papacy did agree to, but John Huss still didn't go and appear before the Pope. So Prague was, the city of Prague was actually banned by the papacy, which was terrible in those days, because when you are banned by the papacy, they will, you know, close off the churches, because the Catholic priests will not preach to those people that they do not find worthy anymore to receive the word, etc. So there's quite some disturbance in the city, of course. So John Huss at that time he withdrew to his birth village, that little village, and he started to preach there, teach the people. But after some time, he came back, because he had that sense of urgency that he needed to share the truth with people. But then, in 1414, there was this crazy, how should I call it, chaos. Because at that time, there were three popes. Don't ask me how, but they were just striving. I mean, one is bad, of course, but there were three, and they were just striving amongst themselves, hiring soldiers, spending money, church money, on soldiers, and yeah, just fighting each other. And of course, they were asking the people in the church to pay more money for blessings and indulgences to finance their fight. And so at a certain point, the emperor at that time, Emperor Sigismund, he decided, okay, we have to do something about this madness, and he decided to call for a council, the Council of Constance. And this council was basically instituted to end the heresy, so also to end the new teachings of John Huss, John Wycliffe, of course, and also to stop the chaos amongst the three popes. So, obviously, Huss was also called before the council, because he was the most well-known teacher of the new truths in the area of Bohemia at that time. So he was called before that council. And he went, though he got from the king of Bohemia, he got a safe conduct, So it was promised to him that if he would go to the council, because he could already imagine what they would want to do to him, of course, because persecutions were just normal business at that time. So he got a safe conduct from the king, and later also from the emperor himself, who would be at the council. So he went with the safe conduct, but yeah, of course, people who are in darkness, they will not keep their promises. And John Huss was imprisoned despite the safe conduct. The quite ironic thing is that the Pope who sentenced him to the imprisonment, he landed up in the same prison. So I thought it was a bit ironic because, yeah, eventually if you want to do evil to others, yeah, it might come back to you someday. But, yeah, basically, as a lot of the reformers, of course, he got the choice between recanting his faith, so taking back all the words of truth that he had shared with the people, or to be burned at the stake. And what I find so inspiring and powerful is that John Huss just had this strength and peace from the Lord, that he made up his mind that no matter what, he would just stand by the truth. And that is exactly what he did. So when he was called, it's a nice illustration, when he was called before the council, and you see the Pope is pointing at him like he is some criminal, he said these words, which I find very, they really touched me, because I think at the end of the day, this is also the question that we should ask ourselves, like if we are in our daily lives, if we are presented with the choice between recanting the truth and choosing our own safety or whatever, we can think of these words of the reformer. He said, "With what face then should I behold the heavens? How should I look upon those multitudes of men to whom I have preached the pure gospel? No, I esteem their salvation more than this poor body now appointed unto death." Great Controversy, page 68. So this reformer, he counted it more joy and of more worth to just die for the truth, which he did. It was when I read this part in the Great Controversy, I had to cry, because just the whole scene, it just seemed so painful to me. I don't know if you can tell from the picture, but the priest, they put on him like a priestly robe, a white one. They put on him like this, how do you call it again, mitre? I don't know if that's the English word. But they put this thing on him. They painted ugly demons on the thing, and they just cursed him. They just cursed him and said terrible things. And they said, "We hand you over to the devil now." But John Huss just said, "I commit my spirit in the hands of the Lord." And so he was taken to the stake, and as they lit the fire, he just started to sing. He just started to sing to the Lord. And of course, eventually his voice died out and he passed away. But his life, but especially his death, was really a strong testimony. It was, yeah, as we know, sometimes something has to die for something else to grow out of it, and that was really the case with John Huss, because the people saw how peaceful he was when facing death, and that is something I believe only the true God can give to people, that courage and that peace. So, let me see what I have. Okay. This is what Sister White says. "His example of faith and constancy would encourage multitudes to stand firm for the truth in face of torture and death. His execution had exhibited to the whole world the perfidious cruelty of Rome. The enemies of truth, though they knew it not, had been furthering the cause which they vainly sought to destroy." Yes, because we shouldn't forget we are not fighting with human beings, but we are fighting with principalities and powers. Yes, so John Huss died 6th of July, 1415, at the stake. And this is one of his quotes that I would like to end with. He says, "Therefore, faithful Christian, seek the truth, listen to the truth.
love the truth, tell the truth, learn the truth, defend the truth, even unto death. Amen.
Hello.
Hello.
My PowerPoint will be like shorter than the other ones, but I hope you will be blessed by it. Martin Luther was born in Eisleben, 10th of November, 1483. Martin Luther, he lived in a family, in actually a rich family, a wealthy family, and there were like mine workers and farmers as well. And during his young days, Martin Luther was asked to actually go to school and study well, because his parents wanted him to study well for good education and also for a good life. And one day, when there was a big storm and Martin Luther was caught in it, lightning was striking everywhere. Being afraid, Luther asked and prayed to a saint called Saint Anne if he would be delivered to it, that he would be a monk. As you can see here, I have a picture of Saint Anne. His prayer was, "Lord, if you save me from this storm, I will become a monk." And eventually, he survived the storm. And after the storm, he became a monk, even though his parents were not like, they were not really like, they didn't agree with it, since they wanted him to study well for his future. But even though Luther knew this, he still became a monk and lived his life and dedicated his life in a monastery. When in a monastery, he had found a Latin Bible, and in his young days he studied Latin and was actually he could speak well fluently Latin and read it well too. When he was reading this Bible, he had never heard of this book, never like read portions of it. He only like read stories about this book. As he was like dedicating his life in the monastery and reading this book, he came to know God more thanks to this Bible. But as he was reading this Bible, he was thinking also about his sins and all these things that he'd done in the past. But thanks to another monk in the monastery itself, he eventually found truth. Like, because the monk was telling him that he was too much thinking about his sins, and that he must actually like put his focus more on God instead of himself, and that God could forgive him for all the sins that he did before. When Luther learned about this, he wanted to study more about this Bible. And here, after Luther was ordained a priest, because he was studying this Bible so much, and people knew he was studying this Bible so much, and also the gospel and the epistles, he was ordained a priest. I was called from a cloister to profession, where he was then going to the University of Wittenberg and applied himself to study the scriptures more in the original tongues. How Luther found light through the scriptures? He found it thanks to this monk, and also thanks to reading it in the original tongues. After he was done studying the scriptures and the original tongues, a friend of him named Stelpitz, a good friend of him, asked him if he could preach to the people. Luther didn't know what to say really. He was more like afraid, and he first said no. But after thinking about it for a while, he did agree to give a study. And as the Great Controversy says, in page 90 and 91, after Luther gave a preaching, Luther's eloquence captivated his hearers. the clearness and power with which he presented the truth convinced their understanding. He began to lecture upon the Bible, and the books of Psalms, the Gospel, and the Epistles were opened and to the understanding of the crowds, and delighted his listeners. First, people didn't really like think it was like really true work, but they were like later convinced that this was the true word of God. When we preach from God's word through the scriptures, the spirit of prophecy, the epistles, and when the Holy Ghost is guiding you, like with our former reformers, we are to be sure that we are preaching God's word. And that was actually the end of our presentation and our PowerPoint.
Amen.
I hope you got blessed by it.
Amen.
We'd like to sing a closing song from this presentation, and it's called Faith of Our Fathers.
I was sitting behind there and I'm wondering, this program ended so quick.
Yeah.
And I shared also with the organizer that this program shouldn't end so quick like that. But we will be back. 14th of April. As I was following the program, the quotation came to my mind when Ellen White was shown in the vision. The group of youth, rightly trained, going door to door to finish the work. It has been a blessing for me, and I hope it has been a blessing for each and every one of us. But we will be back 14th of April. Before we pray, we sang about faith. We talked about pillars of our faith and reformers. I want us to take only 5 minutes to share experiences and testimonies, especially the youth. Could also be an adult who want to share testimony about faith. It's time that in the evenings we always share testimony, but today, a testimony about faith. How have you come? And how has Christ snatched you and brought you to light? Anybody wants to share a testimony before we pray? Anybody? Can I have all those who say they want to share something come in front here so we can share just short testimonies, and then we will close with a word of prayer. All of us who want to share the word of God and how the Lord has helped us, how he has seen us through. Just short testimonies, and then we will close with a word of prayer. Amen?
Amen.
The Bible says they overcome by their word of testimonies. And also, Ellen White says, unless we forget how the Lord has led us in the past. And that's why we share the testimony. So we'll start from Sister Yo.
Hi, everyone.
Hi.
This is not a recent testimony. This is actually kind of a bit old testimony. But it's when I started into Seventh-day Adventist, doing Bible study, I used to go with my sister, Christy, and my sister Dana. We used to go by Brother Eugene's house, and we used to do Bible study, so we were doing it in the night. But in order for me to get there, I had my OVA, you know, we had to travel. But then one night, I lost it during that traveling moment, and I really needed my OVA to go everywhere, you know, so go to Stasia, and then, but we all prayed, and I prayed, and we didn't give up hope. I didn't give up my faith. I didn't went to the attic to get a new OVA. And then one evening we were doing the Bible study, and then a neighbor from Eugene sent a picture of him, hey, we found this ova, and I'm like, oh, that is my ova, you know, like, oh, thank you, Jesus. And then it was amazing because it was like a lot of days passed, and then when you don't give up faith, you see the results, actually how God works in his mysterious ways. That is my testimony.
One time at for school, I had to do like exams. It was on the computer. I had to have like the exact amount percent to actually pass. And I was doing this test. And when I was looking around, I heard a few guys already like failed. And then I started like, no, I'm gonna pass this time. So when I like started to like build up faith, the guy next to me failed. So I was like, okay, it's going to be harder than it looks. So, but after like done like with the last question, I was still like thinking like one question was maybe still wrong, because you had to like get this amount of percent to really pass. If you like lower, then you like have to do it again and maybe pay for it. So at the last moment, I still like waited till to the last second to check if I like maybe passed. So when I like checked at the computer, when like the time was over, I had 75%, and the only thing that I needed was like maybe around 65 or maybe higher. And I was almost like from the only one from the whole class in that group that had to take exams, the one that passed.
Amen.
So I thank God for that.
Amen.
Happy Sabbath. I would like to thank God for all his blessings. It's been quite hard for me here in the Netherlands to find a job. After I finished my studies in 2014, I started looking for a job and started to learn more the Dutch language. But God knows when is the perfect time. I never stopped praying for God to help me. And thanks God, this month, I got a job. I started the 16th of March, and I gave God thanks for answering prayers for my mom, my sister, everyone that I know that also prayed for me. I really want to thank God for that. He never leaves us. He's always going to answer our prayers, but on the perfect time.
And it's her birthday today. Mine is very, very old. 7 years old, I think. So, and it's about when I decided to give my life to God. Who knows who has seen or who has gotten a infused needle? Does anybody ever gotten one? Is it big? Do you find it's big? Is it painful? Okay, so I normally get them. So I had on my left hand an infused needle, and I was really sick. So then two nurses came in the room, and they were like, oh, we gotta give you another infuse. So they gave me one in my right hand. So I was like, okay. And then after like 2 hours, another one came inside. It was like, oh, we gotta give you another one. So they gave me another one on my foot. So I was laying there in a lot of pain, and I was like, this needle is so tiny and so skinny, and I have 3 of them, and I'm here complaining. But Jesus took 3 nails, and they were really big. I can imagine that they were really big and very painful. So if he can do that, why can't I just surrender and give my life for him? So that was the moment I decided to give my life to Jesus.
Good afternoon, church.
Good afternoon.
Mine is also an old testimony. When I was in high school, I became very ill. And my mom and family, they got very worried about me because the doctors didn't know what was the problem. And they gave me tablets and tablets, and it was not working. And my mother was then referred to this other doctor who was a naturopathist. And I was going there for some time, and I started to recover. And I was very thankful to God that he healed me using the natural ways. I didn't know about the Seventh-day Adventist Church then, And then during that time, I got introduced to the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And on one of the afternoon lessons, we were taught about the health message. And to myself, I was wondering, okay, so these people knew all this for all this time, and they never bothered to tell the world about it. I was really hurt that people have got the truth, but they do not want to tell it to others. And that truth can actually save others. I want to testify that there is really power in using the natural methods that God has prescribed for us as his people. And for sure, let us follow that, because God's word is true. And what he has told us through Ellen White, it's very true and it really works. Amen.
Amen.
Mine is also from a few years ago. I had a lot of problems with demons in my daughter head as well. I used to sometimes, demons used to touch me, or I used to see things. I used to hear lots of noises, and I started getting more and more scared, because every time I went to sleep, I thought, oh no, it's going to happen again, and I was really scared. And it took my went on for about 2 years, and then a lady, a friend of mine in another church, told me, she said, you've got to stop being scared, because if you're scared, the devil has a hold on you. And so I started putting music on in the evening, and I started praying, I started reading the Bible, and made sure that the last thought I had was about God before I went to sleep. And that really got rid of the demons. And luckily my daughter's also rid of it now, so she has no, doesn't see anything, doesn't feel anything. And also, I also got rid of it, because it was very bad. And sometimes as you sit in the car, the whole car would just move to the left and the right, and the lower road was not slippery, so really the demon was getting worse and worse, because my fear was increasing. But now I know that if we leave it all at God's feet, and we trust in him and have faith, and we know that he will can take it away, and we ask him for help, he will help us.
Amen.
My story is also a bit old, but it continues and continues. In 1997, I've had a difficult years. I've been ill a lot. I've been in psychiatric hospital. In 1997, I was invited to join a course on Christian faith. I don't recommend that course, but I was raised a heathen, and I was living at that time in a living group because of therapeutic reasons, because of the psychiatric background. And during the course, obviously they were talking about the Bible and that there's a God and that Jesus died for us on the cross. And I thought, that's for them, that can't be for me. And they encouraged the people who joined to go home and pray for themselves. So finally I got the courage to go into my own little apartment and to sit on a bed and to ask God, if you really exist, will you show me? The days after, every night, I had dreams. And normally I knew I had some dreams, but I never remembered them. And now suddenly I had dreams and they had a theme. And they kept on repeating and repeating and repeating. And it was like this that I started to walk through a small ditch with water in it, a small, you know, small stream. In Poland we call it between the meadows, sloten. And then it became bigger, and later it became really a river, so it came till here. And then finally I got this dream that I was swimming, and I was swimming against the current, and I was always on my own. So I knew this is important, and I knew I have to find out, so that made me continue this course. A lot happened. At some point during the course, at some evening there, I had this evening about why, if God exists, why does all this evil in the world happen? And I had my questions, and they could not give answers to them. You know, unlike Great Controversy in the other churches, they give some answers, but they're not really answers, you know. So I went home and I was devastated, because it was the one big question in my heart. And I remember I put my bicycle back in the shed, and I wanted to walk around the building to get to my apartment. And at the moment I shut the door, I just stood outside, and I just stood as nailed to the ground, and I felt this peace. And I still don't know, I'm not advocating anything or promoting anything, but you know, I felt this rushing through me, and a peace and a comfort I never known before. So what it did for me was that it made me to make serious business of God, you know? So I searched through the Bible, and there was a lot I did not understand, but I loved the scripture, and I gave my life to Jesus as far as I knew who he was. And at some point I somehow started to pray, Lord, because I was reading the scriptures, and I read in Song of Solomon, where do you lie down your flock at noon? Where are your, you know, and why should I be involved with your fellow? Do you know that text? Where does your flock lie at rest at noon? So it's indicated something like, is there a real flock then? Is there, you know, I had always learned there are many churches, and it doesn't matter what church you're going to, we all have truth, and it's all Protestant, and I said, no, it can't be real. But somehow I started to pray this, and another prayer that I did was, Lord, give me insight in the times, like Issachar, that I may know what to do. Israel had this insight in times that they should know what Israel should do. And I knew these things were important, but I didn't know what it meant until 2015, and I got acquainted with the videos of World Fight, and I got acquainted with Adventism. And I got acquainted that there are real answers. I got acquainted with the fact that there's one God, one church, one body. You know, God has been leading all this way through. Mm-hmm. To the point now that there's been spoken about martyrs. And I remember I had some meeting. I went to many charismatic meetings. And I'm so grateful that God pulled me through, you know. Amen. And he took a terrible risk by letting me experience those things. But I was willing to give my life. I said, Lord, I want to be a martyr. I didn't know what I was talking about, but I, you know, I did have a sincere heart in some sense. And now we reach this state, and it's getting serious. But I'm so thankful that God has prepared and shows you I was leading it all this time. So, the same with you.
What a friend we have in Jesus. Oh, our sins and grief to bear.
Do
As your children, Father, with thankful hearts, we are bowing before the throne room of grace. All of us, Father, saying, Father, it has been good to be in your house. You fed us with the spiritual food, Father. You fed us again with the physical food. Even this afternoon, Father, you fed us once more with the spiritual food, reminding us of the old path and bidding us to walk therein. Our Lord, our God, great is thy faithfulness, O God our Father. With thankful hearts, we are praising your name for sustaining us, giving us a privilege, Father, to witness others who stood for their faith and bidding us, Father, that you'll never leave us nor forsake us. It's our prayer this afternoon that you keep us faithful, even as you taught us in the morning. Sustain us, Father, that at the end may we say, together with you we have fought a good fight. Together with you we have finished the race. And now we are ready for that crown which you have prepared for us. Keep us faithful, Father. But this we cannot do on our own. And for that reason, we are coming before the throne room of grace, asking you, Father, to give us the gift of your Holy Spirit, the Spirit of truth, that Spirit that comforts us in our weaknesses and giving us strength to continue with the journey that is set before us. This afternoon, in a very special way, our Lord, I'm bringing youth in your name. Dear Lord, I pray that you meet them at their point of need, each and every one. Shield them, Father, and cover them with your righteousness, that in all that they do, may they stand strong, that whoever will be looking at them, should time pass, Father, may the generation that will follow say, those youth stood strong. But Father, we pray that you prepare us for your second coming, each and every one of us. Help us to set aside all the weights that stood around us. Father, that we may run and looking at you, the author and finisher of our faith. I'm praying for our families that are presented here. We understand the evil one is not happy. And he doubles his efforts even as the time get closer and closer. And for that reason, every hour, Father, shield us with your mercy. Give us your holy angels that will always be on our side, protecting us from all danger, seen and unseen. Dear Lord, there is a new week that is ahead of us. Pray for each and every one of us here and those that are not with us here, that you protect us. Even as the new work week, study week starts, we pray, Father, that you save us from busyness of this life, to remind us, Father, to come aside and rest a while in you. To come aside, Father, and learn a while from you. That in all that we do, may we always be abiding at your feet. Forgive us where we have dealt wrongly with one another today. Forgive us where we have looked wrongly at one another today. Forgive us where we have thought wrongly of one another today. Forgive us, Father, where we have spoken wrongly of one another. But above all, Father, forgive us where we have stepped aside and forgot that we were in your presence. Take us, Father, and clean us. Prepare us for meet you. This we pray with forgiveness of our sin. In Christ's name, amen.